Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Let us stand on our feet. Look to the Lord right now and let your dependency be on the need of being with the Lord. Because Jesus is who we need. You can come in, those that are coming, you can come in. But every heart in mind, every being should really look to the Lord right now. We are in need of being in the presence of the Lord. We are in need of being before the Lord today. We are in need. Individually, you are in need of Jesus. Where you're at. Okay, what you're doing this very moment. You are in need of the Lord. You are in need of Jesus. We need to open our hearts. We need to open our hearts. The only way we will ever be changed is if we open our hearts unto the Lord. You're not just coming to a place to hear the word of God, but you're coming to meet the Father. You're coming to meet Jesus. You're coming to meet Jesus. Hallelujah. You're coming to meet Jesus. You're coming to meet him. Because you need him. You need him. Got a lot of stuff that happened to me this week, Lord. I need you right now. I need you. You got a lot of stuff to give to the Lord today. There's a lot of things in your heart that you should leave it in the feet of Jesus. There ain't nobody that can care for you like him. I need you, Jesus. I need you. You want to open up your heart. 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 You won't get into the presence of the Lord if you don't open up your heart. Just opening up your mouth don't mean nothing. If your heart's not connected to what you're saying, you're just talking. to open up your heart. You need to open up your heart. You need to open up your heart. You need to open up your heart. God is requiring for you to speak to Him from out of your heart. God is requiring for you to speak to Him from out of your heart. Open up your mouth as your heart is open. Ushers, do the same thing. Cameraman, do the same thing. Everybody that have breath, I don't care what you're doing this very moment, open up your heart, open up your mouth, talk to the Lord. This is a very serious matter we're doing right now. Don't look around. Don't do nothing else but open up your heart and talk to the Master. Talk to Jesus. Talk to Jesus. Talk to Jesus. Talk to the Lord. I need you, Jesus. Open up your heart. Saints of God, if you don't open up your heart, you'll leave the same way you came in. Open up your heart. Open up your heart. Open up your heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You gotta get out those things that you've held all this week. It's gotta get out of you. It's gotta get out of you. You gotta get it up out of you. There's weight, there's hindrance, there's negative thinking. There's a compoundment of issues inside of your heart that you need to get it up out of you. Talk to Him. Talk to Him. Don't just cry. Open up your heart and open up your mouth. Help yourself to being delivered. Help yourself. Help yourself. Look to Jesus. Help yourself. Help yourself. Get delivered. Be real about this walk. It's coming to an end, y'all. It's coming to an end. This life as we know it is coming to an end. You can't afford to not open up your mouth today. You can't afford to just sit here. You can't afford to just ignore who you really are. You can't afford to let yourself fall because of how you feel. You will be left behind. We are coming to the close. We are coming to the close. We are coming to the close of life. We are coming to the close of life. We are coming to the close of life. Deception is at its highest. Deception is at its highest. We are coming to the close of life. If we don't open our hearts and take out everything, every issue, every single trauma, every single negative thing that we've thought and didn't ask the Lord to wash us for it, that will creep up in your mind and pull you away. It'll pull you away. It'll pull you away.
away. It'll pull you away. It'll pull you away. It'll pull you away. It will pull you away. We are at the time of life we can't afford to play games or allow our minds to tell us that we are not meant to serve God. You will be obeying a lie. Give it up, saints. Your heart needs to be opened. Your heart needs to be opened. Your heart needs to be sincere with the Lord. Your heart needs to be sincere with Jesus. You need to tell the truth about you. You need to overcome you. You need to overcome you. Put yourself in the hand of the man that's able to still the raging waters in your life. Wash me, Lord. Let the Lord, let the Lord, let the Lord, let the Lord, let the Lord. Let the Lord, let Jesus, 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 let him, let him. Open up your heart, saints. Some of you are being stubborn. Open up your heart, saints of God. We are at a time right now where we need to stay before the presence of the Almighty Father. We are at a time right now. We are at a time right now. We are at a time right now such as was never before. Neither will be. Neither will be. We're at a time right now where we need Jesus all the time. We can't make place. We are at a time where we can't make place for how we feel, because you are subject to fall. You're subject to fall. You're subject to fall. You're subject to fall. You're subject to fall. Don't let stubbornness, don't let ignorance, don't let pride stop you from crying out unto God. Don't let pride, don't let that demon stop you. The Lord rebuke thee in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Devil, you're under our feet in Jesus' name. Open up your mouth. Open up your mouth. Open up your mouth. Some of us pack bitterness. Some of us pack judgment. Some of us trying to shake off weariness. Some of us trying to do a whole bunch of things, but it seems to be lingering around. But let me tell you something. This is the time for you to open up your mouth. You can't be so prideful. You can't be so prideful and act like as if it's not you. You need to open up your mouth. Saints of God. He's here to make you free. He's here to make you free. You got some weight and issues in your heart. You got issues in your heart. You got issues in your heart. Issues in your heart. Weight in your heart. Weight in your heart that you need to let go. God has been pleading with delivering word for a good while now. He's been pleading with delivering word for a good while now for you to stop serving him based upon emotion. Stop serving him based upon emotion. Stop serving him based upon emotion. He wants real deal. He wants real deal. It's got to be from out of the heart. You can't serve him based upon how you feel, because you're not always going to feel safe. Let it go. Let it go. Let him go. Let him go right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your issues go right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Let him go. Let him go. Let him go. Let him go. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let him go. Let him go. Let him go. Let him go. Give him to the Lord. 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 Give him to Jesus. Give it 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 to the, give it to him. Give it to him. Give it to Jesus. Give it to him. Give it to him. Give it to him. Issues in your heart. Trauma that you can't take care of. Problems. 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 Errors. Difficulties. Struggling in your mind, wavering in your faith, trouble everywhere you go. If it ain't this, it's that. It's time to let it go. It's time to let it go. Let it go. It's not going to help you in the time of you being raptured. It's not going to help you. It's not going to help you. It's not going to help you, saints of God. It's not going to help you. It's not going to help you. It's not going to help you. When you're loaded, weighted down in your heart, you got trouble and drama and issues just compacting inside your heart. Don't know how to let go. Open your mouth and confess it, and it will let go. Issues that beat you down daily. Issues that cause negative thinking about you. Issues that cause you to sway in your faith in Jesus Christ. Issues. Issues that make you judge folk. Issues that make you say, I'm not good enough. Issues that stop you from being or having a good life in Christ. Issues, issue, issue, issue. If it ain't one thing, it's the other. It's an issue. It's an issue. You don't even realize it's a demon that put it inside your mind to stop you from prospering. It's a devil that put it inside your mind to stop you from going with Jesus Christ. Issues, it's time to let it go. It's time to let it go. It's time to let it go. Drama. You don't forgive. You hold on. You don't know how to let go of things. Things just ponder in your mind because you really did not let it go. You can't forgive nobody. You want to, but you're stuck between two opinions. Drama.
drama. And every time you look at a person, it rises up in your heart again. That's issues. That's issues. You try to push it down. You can't push it down. You got to let go of it. That's been the weight. That's been the weight that's hindering you from prospering spiritually. That's also the weight that'll stop you from going with Jesus Christ. We are at the close of what's called life world. God is about ready to crack the cloud. Oh my Lord. He's about ready to crack the cloud, and some of us act like as if it ain't really gonna happen. Your heart will drop. Your heart will drop when you see Jesus coming in the cloud. Your heart will drop, and you will say within yourself, I'm missing out. I'm missing out. It's coming, saints of God. Don't think these are words. Jesus is coming. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. And there ain't no delaying. There's no delaying in his coming. There's no delaying in anything. He's coming. He's coming. If your heart ain't right, if your heart ain't right, if your heart's not right, if your heart's not right, you will be left behind. And what a destruction is coming upon man for the sins committed before the eyes of the Father. What a destruction that's coming. The earth will be burned with fire. The earth will be burned with fire. The earth will be burned with fire. All the elements that you see will be burned with fervent fire. With fervent fire. With fervent fire. He's coming. He's coming. He's coming. The day you hear his voice, don't think it's man talking. Hallelujah, glory be to God. This is reality of what's about to come. This is the reality of what's about to come. And the devil want to bring confusion in your heart. He want to bring confusion in your mind to bring you to a point of backsliding. He wants to bring confusion in your mind. Get you to judge things. Get you to be angry about things. Get you to feel abandoned, stripped. They ain't doing me right. I'm always going through it. Whatever the case might be, get you to gripe, get you to complain. It's a tactic that the devil has allowed. Listen, he is allowed to do that. But if you let him, you'll fall right along to his hand. We're at the point of no return, saints of God. We're at the point of no return, saints of God. We're at the point of no return, saints of God. We're all gonna die one day. But what you do now determines on whether you go on with the Lord or not. I wanna remind you this. You're not gonna live forever. Not on the natural sense, but on the spiritual sense you will. But if you think God is not talking, then I feel bad for you. Because these words are going to come back to your mind when you're standing before the Father at judgment. And he's going to remind you, I've warned you, I've talked to you, I've been the one pleading for your soul even before this death came, and you did not hear me. You did not hear me. The weight that was in your heart blocked the word of warning. The weight that was in your heart blocked the word of warning.
This is a warning to delivering word. 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 Delivering word, you need to get your heart right. Delivering word, you need to get your heart right. Delivering word, you have become one to sit and compile things inside your heart to the point that it almost and it literally is stopping you from flourishing spiritually. We allowed issues to creep up in our heart and linger and think about them continually and have allowed weight to stay there. Issue, one thing after the other, and neglected to get before the presence of the Lord to go on ahead and have Him wash us of these issues. Conform to emotion. Conform to emotion. It's how the service of God is given. The Father wants to relieve you. He wants to save you from that mindset. Conform to emotion stops you from serving God. Conform to emotion stops you from seeking the Lord. Conform to emotion stops you from reading, stops you from going before the Lord, stops you from pleading, stops you from asking the Lord, please take over my mind. Conform to emotion hinders your faith. Conform to emotion stops you from growing. Conform to emotion keeps you complaining. Conform to emotion keeps you nagging. Conform to emotion keeps you judging. Conform to emotion keeps you complaining. When you conform to emotion, you feel weak. You feel abandoned. You feel like a hypocrite. You feel like a backslider. You feel no good. You feel the struggles like as if it, you just can't get out of it when you conform to emotion. You should say, how did I get here? How did I get here? How did I get here? I'll tell you how you got there. Somewhere along the line, you close your heart. Somewhere along the line, you've closed your heart. You stop listening from out of your heart. You just were listening from out of your ear. This is the reason why you struggled to serve God throughout the week. And you just went back to the same old. It's like as if you were just living somebody else's life. It's like you were living a movie. Like you can't believe these things are happening to you. But in the beginning, when you first came to Jesus, you came to Him with all of your heart. Faith was, it was a joy to come to the house of God. It wasn't a pressure. It wasn't a weight. It wasn't a burden. It was a joy. It was a joy. When did we drop our joy? We got wrapped up, saints of God, in contentment. We got content. We got to be content. And not smoking and drinking and thinking that that's part of salvation. We drop Jesus off along the way and begin to live a religious life of outward appearance. So if we don't feel like we gotta serve God or look to God or literally be in need of God, we believe it and we don't do nothing about it. Our seeking has been diminished because we have served God based upon how we wake up to feel. Yes.
from out of our heart. We started judging how we live on a daily basis instead of judging what's in our heart. Instead of judging what's in our heart. If we didn't have a rough beginning of the day, there really wasn't no need to serve, to search, or to look, or to go on ahead and go before the Lord. I'm in need of you, Lord. I'm in need of you, Lord. I'm in need of you, Lord. We stop seeking the Father from out of our heart. We don't pay attention to what's in our heart. We turn the blind eye to our ways and wait for the devil to condemn us. So that way, maybe, possibly, we can look to the Lord. And if he does condemn us, we believe the condemnation so much that we get swayed with deception. So we don't seek the Lord because he calls us a hypocrite. And you believe you're a hypocrite, so you don't look to the Lord because you feel like a hypocrite. So in your eyes, he turned your view. He turned your viewing into hypocrisy. So you stop seeking the Lord. But when you first gave your life to Jesus, you knew you didn't want to be no hypocrite. You wanted to serve God the right way. Where did you stop? Where did you stop? Where did you allow your emotion to lord your relationship between you and Jesus? Where did you allow your emotion to govern your faithfulness in Jesus? Where? In what time frame of your walk in Christ were you able to say, I feel all right. I don't need to search for him as much. I feel all right. I feel good. I feel good. And you base that to say that that's really how you really are. But you didn't, you overlooked the attitude that you had 3-4 hours before that. You overlooked the judgment that you had on a brother or a sister or the pondering of negative thoughts against somebody. You overlooked that. You overlooked that. You overlooked that. So we wake up. We wake up. And if we feel at peace, we believe we're at peace. But your heart looms in your mind the things that need to get up out of you, and you think that's the devil trying to condemn you. God is saying there's parts of your heart that I need to be washed. There's parts of your heart that need to be washed. There's parts of your heart that need to be washed. There's parts of your heart that need to be washed. There's issues in your heart that needs to come out. There's issues in your heart that you need to confess. Not to man, to me, God is saying. He said, cast all your cares unto me, for I care for you. He said, I care for you. I care for you. Hallelujah, 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 thank you, Lord. Issues, old issues, family issues, trauma issues, work issues, school issues, brother against sister issue, husband against wife issue, wife against husband issue, financial issues. They ponder in your heart, and we overlook them like as if we're clean enough. You live in a life that's always in need of washing. If your natural skin needs to be washed daily, because it secretes the nastiness from your body. We're living in a world that we ought to be begging the Lord continually to wash us. Because what we see with our natural eyes, because we're not strong enough, it affects our heart. It affects our heart. It affects our heart. And if we look back, our response shows that we've been affected on a negative sense. And God's mercy and His grace, glory be to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. He's always pleading, saying, I want to wash you. He's the breasted one that's always saying, I want to wash you. I want to wash you. Wake up in the morning, and He's constantly putting in your mind, come before me, come before me, come before me. That's Him stating, I want to wash you this morning. I want to take you a spiritual bath. I want to make your day light. I want to make you burdenless. I want to make you clean in my sight. I want to make you delivered. I want to create in you today a clean heart and a right spirit. I want to give unto you. Because He loves you. And He cares for you. If He didn't care for you, He wouldn't have His arms stretched out unto us right now as He has it right now. This is a caring Father. He's a caring God. Jesus is the breasted one. He cares about you. He cares about where you're going to end up. He cares about what you got going on in your mind. Do you not think that He discerns to the marrow of the bone? Well, if He discerns that deep, He knows the intent and the thought of your heart. And there are things in our heart that we tend to put back. There are things in our heart that we tend to put back, and there are things in our heart that we tend to go on ahead and ignore and think that it's not there. But our action show that it is there. Our action show that it's there. It's there. It's there. It's there. It's there. The only one who can get rid of it is you. It's you by your opening up your mouth. Him. Some of you, because you don't seek the Lord, the enemy's word is right there at your ear. The Lord, is pleading. He's pleading, y'all. He's pleading. There is a deep care for you that Jesus has for you. There's a care for you. When you didn't care for yourself, you ain't alive based upon your ability. You're alive because He loves you. All of us are alive because He loves us. And we're not worthy of nothing that He does for us. But yet His grace and His mercy keeps us continually being awoken or awakened for another chance. We abuse God's mercy by not taking advantage of the cleansing time. And then we want to seek the Lord, but there's a spirit that tells you in your mind, sit down, you hypocrite, and you believe it. And you believe it. And God is saying, I come that you might have life, and life more abundant. And you would rather listen to another deity and tell you that you ain't worthy. Sit down and shut up because you look stupid. This is the issue that role plays in your mind, even when you're in the sanctuary of God. And the majority of you listen to that. You listen to it. And you obey it. And when you feel you've given God enough, your cry isn't as long as it would be if you lose out totally. You know, we cry real hard when we're pushed up against the corner. We cry real hard and want God to move, 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 and want God to move. And when he don't move, when he don't move, and you hear a demon tell you, see, I told you God don't want you no more, you believe it. We don't have endurance no more. We don't have endurance. You know why we don't have endurance like we used to? Because we pushed our heart out of the way. Before we can take something and forgive somebody real quick, now we're so fragile. We're so fragile that if somebody looks at us wrong, we think they have an issue with us. Restore us, Father. Restore us to the very beginning. You said that you gave the living word as a ministry of restoration. Reconcile us, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus. Reconcile us. You want to be reconciled, ask the Lord, reconcile me, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Reconcile me, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. Reconcile me, reconcile me, reconcile me, Lord. Reconcile me. Restore me, make me anew, make me anew, make me anew. Reconcile me, Lord. Restore me. Restore me. I want to go back. 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 I want to go back to trusting you. I want to go back to holding on to the faith. I want to go back, Lord. I want to go back. I want to go back to love, Lord. I want to go back to love, Lord. I want to go back to love. I don't want to go back to issues. I don't want to go back to issues. I want to go back to love. 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 Calling you. He's calling you. He's calling you. Man of God, he's calling you. He's calling you. Reconcile me, Lord. reconcile. I don't hear too many people saying that. Reconcile me. Restore me, Father. Restore me, Lord. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me. Don't let you, don't let a flesh, don't let a feeling, don't let emotion stop you from being blessed. The Lord is going to restore us to the very beginning today. I want to tell you this right now. I want to tell you this right now. I want to tell you this right now. What you'll experience today, it's like you being born again for the very first time. Restore me, Lord. Restore me. Restore me, Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, restore me. Restore me to love. Restore me to love. Restore me, Lord. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, in the mighty name of Jesus, in the mighty name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Restore me, Lord. Open up your mouth. What you ask, you will receive. What you ask, you will receive. Restore me, Lord. Restore me, Lord. Restore me, Lord. We're in the presence of the Almighty God. We're in the presence of the Lord. Jesus is in this place right now. We're in His presence. Restore me. Restore me. Restore my mind. Restore my spirit. Restore my conscience. Give me love again. Hallelujah. Give me love. Cry out. Don't whisper it, saints of God. Don't whisper it. Don't whisper it. Cry out. Open up your mouth. Cry out. Cry out. Restore my heart, Lord. 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 In the mighty name of Jesus. 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 Restore me, Lord. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me. Open up your mouth. Open up your mouth. Those of you that are pleading to the Father. Those of you that are pleading to the Father. Let heaven hear your requests. Let heaven hear your requests. Your heart wants to open up your mouth and speak what's in your heart. Your heart wants to. Don't let no devil tell you in your mind, you look stupid. Don't let them rob you. You've been robbed long enough. You've been raped long enough. You've been taken advantage of long enough. Restore me. Restore me, Father. Restore me, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. Restore me, Father, in the mighty name of Jesus. Restore me with your love. Restore me with your mind. Restore us, Lord, with your care. Restore us with faith, Lord. Restore us, Lord. God will rain down when you open up your mouth. When you open up your mouth and ask Him to restore you, He'll rain down in you. He'll rain down in you. He will rain down in you your requests. When you ask Him from out of the depths of your heart, when you ask Him from out of the depths of your heart, He will rain it down on you. He will rain it down on you. He will give you what you ask. He'll give you. He'll give you. He'll give you your requests. He'll give you your requests. Don't let no spirit tell you otherwise. Don't let no spirit keep your mouth shut. Don't let no spirit tell you or make you think things over. Don't let them make you think things over. This is your time of change.
Open up your mouth. Open up your mouth. Open up your mouth. Restore me, Lord. Restore me. Restore my mind. Restore my heart, Lord. Restore my endurance, Lord. Restore my faith, Lord. Restore my conscience, Lord. Give me a purified mind. Give me a heart to serve you. Give me a love, Lord. Give me a love such as was never before, Lord. Give me a love for your word. Give me a love for your presence. Give me a love. Addict me, Lord. Put an addiction in my heart, Lord, for your presence, Lord. Put an addiction in my mind, Lord. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me, Lord. Restore me. I need you, Lord. I need thee. Don't stop pleading, saints of God. Don't let contentment, don't let an emotion of contentment stop you from pleading. Don't let an emotion from contentment stop you from pleading. This is what the Lord is talking about. You feel good, so you stop. Don't let an emotion of contentment stop you from pleading. Don't let an emotion of you all right, you good, you did enough. No, you're not good enough. Your mind, body, and soul has to be given to the Father. If the heart and the mind is not given to the Father, the emotion will take over you and control you. And you'll be in areas in your life that you thought you'd never be in. Restore, Lord, every soul. Father, every soul that's pleading unto you right now. Pour out, Lord. Pour out, Lord, a refreshing within their heart, Lord. Rejuvenate, regenerate them in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Restore me, Father. Restore me, Lord. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me to the beginning, Lord. Restore me to love. Lord, I got hate in my heart. I got judgment in my heart, Lord. I got anger in my heart. I got bitterness in my heart, Lord. I got unbelief in my heart, Lord. I have doubt in areas of my life, Lord. I have doubt in areas of my life, Lord. I get challenged, Lord, and sometimes I believe more the negative, Lord, than your word and your promises, Lord. Please restore me, Lord. Please restore me to the very beginning. Restore me to the very beginning. Restore my heart. Restore my mind. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me. Restore me.
the storm. Restore me. Restore my commitment. Restore my commitment. My walk in you. My joy, my peace, my love. Temperance, Lord. The long suffering that I need. Restore it unto me. Restore it. That I may be a pleasure. That I may be a pleasure. That I may be a pleasure unto you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, you're worthy. You're worthy of all the glory. You're worthy of all the praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You're worthy of it all, Lord. You're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all. Hallelujah. You're worthy of it all. Glory be to your name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You're worthy of it all. You're worthy of it all, Lord. You're worthy of it all. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Jesus, hallelujah.
Thank you.
He's blessing you. He's blessing you. He's blessing you. Let him move. Let him move for you. Let your inner man rejoice. Let it go. There's a freedom in your heart right now. There's a freedom in your heart right now. There's a freedom. Rejoice. Freedom that the Father has given you. You can thank Him. Be seated in the presence of the Lord. Forgive, even when He was hurt by us in our unbelief,
in our complaints. He's willing to take the blow. Forgive that we may move on. Some of us don't know how to move on from an infraction or from situations or issues that occur in our lives. For that, we allow that issue to determine who we are in the Lord and who we are in our spirit. Those issues create burdens, and those burdens hinder you from prospering spiritually. And in those burdens, you feel the mechanism called weight. And that weight is the continual accusation. It's a continual accusation of you not being good enough. But the Word of God says, I come that you might have life. I come that you might have life and have life more abundant. That sounds like God the Father judged you to be worthy enough to be redeemed. You see, when you come to the Lord, you come by faith. This is where your faith gets to be enacted. When you struggle with faith, you struggle to let go of what you've been repenting about. It's good to ask God to forgive you, but it's better to forgive yourself also in the same time. Because you must understand, you have to forgive yourself in order for you to know more about you. If not, you'll be stuck here. Well, there's more about you that the Father wants to show you based upon life circumstances that He created for you to go through. But and we take that mindset into salvation. To absolutely believe that we're by ourselves. Well, the Word of God is a lie when He says, I'll never leave you, neither forsake you. He's lying then when He says, I'll be there even before you call. So if we swayed, if we believe that we're by ourselves and that ain't nobody there with us, then we have determined that our walk in Christ is short-lived. And in us determining that, we find out that we really didn't trust God as we should have, in a walk. So maybe instead of saying, I quit, or instead of saying, this is too hard, instead of saying, I don't know if this is for me, instead of saying, well, church ain't my cup of tea, maybe we should reevaluate in what mindset we were really serving God in. So that way we can understand that faith come by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. And if we have faith, then faith means you entrust. You're convicted of the truth. And faith causes you to hold on to promises. See, a promise is not yet developed if it's still a promise. A promise is something that you are about to obtain without you having it in your possession. Just like your job promises you to give you a check every week, God promises you to give you life every day. And only in Jesus will you ever receive that life. in our lifespan, when we serve God and have been convinced that our dependency has been challenged and we haven't really trusted God as we should have, in areas that we trust God more, if we really examine ourselves, we trust God more in other areas in life than what we do in other areas in our other life. So we trust God more in supplying what we are accustomed to religiously having: food, shelter, clothes. But when it comes down to trusting Him for patience and power and temperance and meekness and joy, that we get challenged. When God wants to keep us and cause there to be an endurance within our spirit, man, our endeavoring to do what the Lord say do tends to be a discouraged situation when we get convinced that this is far too much for me to handle. And if we say within ourselves, this is just too much for me, then we've given up the faith to rectify the flesh. Now we're caught up in another circumstance, which if we continue that realm, we'll end up falling into what the scripture says, a religious lifestyle. And we will be like the Pharisees and the Sadducees, where we'll get emotionally disturbed when we get talked about, or when we get hit, or when we go through trials and can't endure temperance. Temperance comes when God is allowing trouble to happen to you for the sake of keeping endurance in you. Far too often, we don't want to endure things no more. We don't want to endure things no more. This whole world and the inhabitants thereof have gotten to be a quick fix generation. If it don't happen in the time span that I believe should happen, I have a problem fully trusting that what I've heard was the absolute truth. Hallelujah. Here we are at the height of our walk. And in what direction should I really serve the Lord in? There's only one thing that the Father ever required from you. Ever one thing. See, we think that our walk in Christ is based upon the things that we do. But you could do everything right on a natural sense, but leave your heart out of. The only thing that the Father, that Jesus ever came to clean was the heart. He came to clean the heart. Because if the heart is clean, then the mind will follow what's in the heart. If your heart is clean, if your heart is clean, then your intention, your actions will complete your intention. Because you'll have good intentions. But if your heart's not clean, and if your heart reserves things, if you allow your heart to to be impacted by impurities of your mind, then your mind now lords your life. Because out of the abundance of the heart, out of the abundance of the heart, out of the abundance of your heart, that's how you live. So if in your heart there's shadiness, if you're a little shysty, if you're the type of person that really don't like to go on ahead and share, if you're the type of person that always believes that you always get the raw end of the stick, if you're the type of person that can't really forgive folk, then that's gonna carry on. And if you neglect to ignore what the Father is trying to show you throughout the week about you, then you are making place for division to be between you and the Father. See, the heart speaks reality. The Word of God distinctly said they crucified Jesus and got on him real hard because his disciples ate with unwashed hands. And they picked on him, they jeered him, and said, why is it that your disciples eat with unwashed hands? You ain't even supposed to go on ahead. You're supposed to wash your hands first. Jesus said, it's not what goes in the man that defiles the man. It's not what goes in you. It's not what you eat. Are you understanding me? It's not what you eat. It's what comes out of you. It's your response, your action. It's how you believe. It's how you respond to negative. It's how you respond to positive. It's how you respond. Your response tells on your heart. And your response is the manifestation of what's hidden in your heart. And if your response ain't right, your heart ain't right. And we carry this throughout the day, throughout the week, and act and ignore who we really are. God is showing us that we're some impatient, short, patient, nagging, complaining, frustrated, easily distracted, easily disturbed, non-faithful individuals. Because we always make place for our emotion. We always like to complain about things. You know, we complain about the trials that the Lord has allowed us to go through and all that, as to say we ain't supposed to go through nothing like this. But in your heart, you got reservation to do things your way. No wonder why it is challenging for us to really know the voice of God. Because a sheep follows a shepherd. And a shepherd won't lead the sheep astray. If a sheep goes out of the realm of protection, God sends his word, which is the dog, to run around to keep the sheep in order. And if the sheep is a little stubborn, the dog will literally nip at the rear end of the sheep, and the sheep will go back among the herd. Well, if your conscience don't condemn you, neither will I. If the word of God is in your conscience, you won't be condemned. But if the word of God is in your conscience, your actions will be checked. And you will have an experience of remorseful to say, I'm sorry, I did wrong. Sorry for what? I shouldn't have spoken to you. No, you're fine. No, please. You won't overlook it to think that it's the enemy trying to, because you'll realize that inside of your heart, there needs to be purification done. You're not purified when you continually make place for your heart to demonstrate what's really been tucked away inside you. Jesus is a lover. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. See, our heart has a memory base in it that's so deep and so long that your heart tends to remind you, like Facebook reminds you. 5 years ago, you were here, remember? Well, if you didn't upload that on Facebook, it never would have reminded you. If your heart would have never uploaded what the offense was, it never would have reminded you. If you would have forgave, like you said you forgave, it never would have reminded you. Because to what remembrance would you have if you let it go? But a sincere heart has love and pity with it. A sincere heart can't hide the fact that they need help to be purified. And if we don't really come to the point of the truth about us, not him, her, or them, us, then the word of God will be complete when he said we will hold truth in unrighteousness. So we'll hold what to do and how to do it, but yet won't do nothing to change it. If we could just serve God from out of our heart, nobody would have to teach you to seek him. Nobody would have to teach you to get with him. You wouldn't be asking, how do I, because your heart will drive you to complete. But because of the world in our heart. Now the world comes when there's the pride of life, the lust of the eye. Or when the pride of life is there, you don't want to forgive nobody. You don't want to forgive nobody. You don't even want, when you have the pride of life, you don't even want to be viewed as wrong. You don't want to be viewed as wrong. And if you do take wrong, it's for the sake of shutting somebody up. That's not service to God out of a pure heart. But a pure heart always knows when it got touched. When it got touched with anger or bitterness or judgment or condemnation. Sometimes we can condemn folk in our mind and bring them to a judgment to say that they ain't such and such. When we do that, our heart is contaminated. Our heart is contaminated. And when we excuse, I'm sorry, but when we excuse ourselves, we make place
in hell. Our judgments are wrong when we judge folk in the wrong manner. When we have a contaminated heart, our judgments are wrong. When we have a contaminated heart, we're short patient with one another. We don't even want to put ourselves in somebody else's shoes. When our heart is contaminated, because we believe we're right at that specific time frame. And in spite of whatever goes wrong, we still hold on to what we believe is right. I didn't do nothing wrong. I didn't say nothing wrong. I don't understand. And you don't even check your actions out. You don't even check your loyalty out. You don't even check who you've really been demonstrating yourself to be. And so we need to go on ahead and conversate with somebody that can relate to how we feel. And all we're doing is bringing trash from one trash can to the other trash can, sharing banana peels that are brown and all that, and contaminated juices and everything else. And that's all we're doing is keeping each other polluted. Because we haven't learned to establish a real relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what causes us to end up becoming bad fathers, no good moms, bad brothers and sisters, bad sister toward the sister, bad brother toward the brother, and bad brother in the church, one against another. This is what causes confusion and animosity and all of that, because we have not individually learned how to establish a relationship with God. See, we want to try to figure out how God, the service of God, really is. You can't figure heart out, because heart does things that they get struck and they still say, I forgive you. You can't figure heart out. Because when heart has love, it's there before you call. I already forgave you. I love you. When you have love, you don't carry gossip. You know, such and such and such. You know, when you don't have love, you're the biggest tale bearer. Instead of giving it to Jesus, you give it to somebody else. When you don't have love, when you have love, you're careful. I don't want to contaminate. When you got love, if a brother says something to you that touched you, and you're like, nah, I don't let that mess with me. And if they come home, sorry, man, I love you, man. Come on, stop. But if we don't have love, saints of God, we'll be living religious. Because we'll always try to figure out, well, how do you do this and how do you do that? How do you do this and how do you do that? How do you do this and how do you do it? And now I got to go on ahead and counsel you over something that all you had to do was apply your heart with. When the heart's not applied, you die. Hear me. David said, thy word have I hid in my heart. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. What is he saying? He's saying, thy word have I hid in my deepest part of my heart, that if I find myself being out of order, oh, forgive me, Father. But if the word is not in our heart, then there really is no commitment being made to the Father. See, loyalty comes when the heart is applied. I love you like a brother. So when you need me, I'm there for you. If you need me and I can't be there for you, you'll make me feel so bad that I can't be there for you. Oh, I feel so bad. If you got love for me,
or you got love for the other brother, you say, no, it's okay. Don't worry about it. Our love for the Lord ought to be based upon from the center. It shouldn't be, if you do this for me, then it's mandated for me to do that for you. Because when one loves one another, when you do something, it's exciting to go on ahead and do it for them too. And then to see the reaction about what you've done for them. Well, what you think God does when he touches your heart to go before him. And he tells you to seek him. And other things get in the way. What was really in our heart that allowed us to be steered away when God called us before that disturbance came? We need to be brutally honest with ourselves and stop making place for lies. Because if we really examine ourselves, we really understand that I am in need of purified mindset every single day. If we're really real within ourselves, we'll say, you know what? I need you right now, Jesus. Not because it's the proper thing to do in the morning. I just do. I need you right now. And when you do something from out of your heart, you do it because you want to. Not because the word of God said so. It's because your heart is driving you to the commitment that's in your heart toward the Father. And when you're driven to do something, you won't be fully completed or content until it gets finally done. Your loyalty will always be on the examination board. The loyalty of Jesus Christ was always there when he was tempted, such as you and I are. Temptation comes to try to sway you away to do the opposite. Hear me very closely. He was tempted in all points, such as you and I. So if he was tempted in all points, that means in every area we will ever face, collectively, Jesus, one man, had experienced it altogether. Because there are things that I'm going to experience that he might not experience, or you might not experience. But there are things that you're going to experience that I might not experience. But there's one who experienced it all. His name is Jesus. This is the reason why we should look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. Why? Because he knows how to get out. His other name, he's called the door. Because he makes a way for you to come out of your scenarios. Are you hearing this? Our heart has to be emptied. This is the reason why the Father was stating this morning. You got to empty out your heart. Believe it or not, us Gentiles, a Gentile is every nation besides the Jew. Chinese, black, you can be from wherever in the world. If you're not a purified Jew, you're a Gentile. Gentiles are very paganist. We're very paganist. We're pagan individuals. We like to have memorials. I want you to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. We like to have memorials. If we don't set a memorial on the outside, we'll set a memorial inside of our heart. You know what that means? That's a remembrance. It's a remembrance. We remember more than we want to. We're very paganist, very pagan.
Not only do we remember the times of festivity and all that, but we also remember the times of hurt, the times of disappointment, the times when somebody done you wrong, and you got the biggest piano, the biggest violin, and you play it so sweet the moment that thought comes back up. Because you remember that memorial is in your heart. And we can't serve God living a lie. You know what the lie is? Ignoring what you gotta work on and saying that it's not there. In your actions. That's a lie.
You know, if you don't put deodorant on, you'll be musty. You know that, right? You'll be musty.
And you know, it's kind of a customary to go on ahead and have a musty man. You know, men smell musty. But when a woman smells musty, because men have this thing in them that it just perspirates, it's constantly just stanking up, and it needs to be washed.
Well, your mind, if your mind is not right, it'll perspirate sin, it'll perspirate iniquity, and if iniquity, excuse me, is not checked, it births out sin. And when sin is not checked, sin develops death. Your heart is the number one thing that God the Father wants. You could do all the praying, you could do all the seeking, you could do all the this, the that. You could do all that on the outward sense, and yet still experience dryness. Do you know why? It's because you covered your heart for the sake of keeping a religious realm of how to do things. Is it that we could be in the shower and the water is on, the water's hitting us, and yet we say we dry? We're in the shower, it's on, and yet we say, well, I'm experiencing dryness. That would be a lie. So will it also be, is if you try to go before the Lord without your heart. You see, your heart is the main. God don't want to wash your natural body. That's your responsibility. He's not going to come down and bathe you like how you bathe your babies. Stay still now. He ain't going to do that. You wash your own body. But there's a spirit body, there's an inner part about you that he washes. And it can only be washed by the presence of the Lord. See, God resists the proud, but he giveth grace unto the humble. And he resists the proud when you try to go before him, not really telling on you. Not being honest about you. You got pride. Pride. Pride hinders you from flourishing. Pride stops you in every shape, form, or fashion. Pride stops you. Pride stops you from getting corrected. Pride stops you from going ahead and moving forward in life. Pride stops you. Pride stops you in every area of your life. It literally abandons every prosperous way that you could ever have. Pride does. Pride. And when you're a proudful individual, you don't want to hear from nobody. You pick and choose who you want to hear from. And then if they don't give you what you want to hear, you stop hearing from them. Because you're a prideful individual. Well, if pride is in your heart, you won't come before the Lord. Because you feel you can try to figure it out. Don't help me, I got this. No, you don't. No, you don't. Pride don't want to admit at all. You know you're wrong. Well, I really wasn't wrong because, truth be told, you don't want to admit. But grace given to the humble is the individual to say, Father, I'm contaminated. Father, I don't want to hold truth in unrighteousness. This is who I really am, Lord. I'm a lustful individual. I'm short patient. I get angry. I want to fight. I want to just, Lord, I want to do things. I get touched with these emotions, and I don't want to do them, Lord, but they feel so real, Lord, and I find my actions always lashing back. And when you don't go before the Lord confessing these things, guess what will happen? It'll come back on you again. And you wonder, how did I get here? How did I get here? You know what happens? It's that you've neglected the need of your heart. You've neglected the need of your heart. This is how you neglect the need of your heart. When the Father tells you, get up and go before me. And you just lay there. Because your flesh is another deity telling you, no, you're tired. You just get extremely tired out of the blue. And all of a sudden, you fall asleep. You wake back up, and now it's time for you to get to work. Now you walk in what's called a condemnation. And that condemnation is a tactic that the enemy uses against you. And God, see, you don't know what to say. But the scripture says that the Spirit when you don't know what to say, the Spirit giveth utterance. He giveth utterance. So see, you think, what am I saying now? I done said everything. No, there are things about you that you haven't opened up. That's fine to get before the presence of the Lord and all that. And there are things that you start confessing. You're like, wow, I can't believe that. Wow, I never really asked the Lord to forgive me for that. But you're hindering your growth. So great a salvation do you neglect when you hinder that part. When you hinder that part. Do you understand God is causing you to know his voice when he tells you, get up and go seek me. But when you don't do it, you're refusing the instructions of the Father. And then you end up saying, well, how do you know God's voice when he told you to get up and you still lay there? Tells you, get up, go seek me. Get up, give me time. Get up, go to the living room. Get up, go to the other room. Get up, he'll put a scripture in your mind. He'll put a scripture in your mind. It's not for the church, it's for you. And out of the heart, we lack loyalty. Out of the heart, we lack loyalty. But yet, if somebody else isn't as loyal to us as we are to them, then we get challenged with forgiving. But we're not as loyal to the Father as he is to us. But we won't go on ahead and want the Father to condemn us. We want him to forgive us. There's something wrong in the heart when the heart can excuse or refuse. Loyalty always comes directly from your throne. This is where God sits. This is where he sits. This is where he sits and governs you. This is where he sits and directs you. This is where he sits and corrects you. This is where he sits and instructs you. This is where he sits and literally magnifies you spiritually. If he's not there, then what is there will show up. No matter what you do to try to suppress it. See, you think suppressing it. God don't want you to suppress nothing. Could you imagine? You got trash in your house, in your kitchen. And you mess around and make benin the night before. And you suppress it. You push it down to the bottom. Are you hearing me? Then you make what is that thing called again? What's that thing called again? What's it called in Spanish? It's cow stomach. I forgot what it's called. Whatever it's called. Mofongo? Mondua? Mondongo. You make that and you suppress that with the benin. Now you got 2-day-old benin and then you got pieces of cow stomach in there just deteriorating. Then you make chitlins. And you know, if you don't clean chitlins, it smell like booty. You don't clean it right, it stinks from the very beginning. And you suppress that in your trash can. You leave for 2-3 days, and you didn't even leave your AC on, and it is hot. In other words, you have the hot issues of life. You got fiery trials. My wife has them. If my wife was ever an animal, she's going to be a German Shepherd. Because she can sniff anything out. You smell that? No, I don't smell that. I smell it. I don't know what you're talking about, babe. You don't smell that? No, I don't smell it. Stinks. You come into the house and you get a hit of stankness. Now, if you walk past the dumpsters in Charter Home in the summertime, after they dump it, and the wind blows just right, you might can smell it at Zotto's. child at home, you know what I'm talking about. But your spirit is like that, saints of God, where your demeanor can be seen a mile away. What's wrong with you?
Nothing.
Your heart can be seen a mile away. And when your heart is contaminated, a blind man can see, not literally, but figuratively speaking, your aura will be felt before they come around you. And when the reality of you shows up, the moment you go on ahead and justify yourself is the moment you hide it back in you, the moment you suppress it back, you push it down. See, God don't want nothing you got to offer. Listen, if money was a factor, then let me share this with you. When they went on ahead and they wanted to buy the Holy Ghost, that man wanted to buy the Holy Ghost would have been sold. And he would have been so expensive right now that you wouldn't have enough money to pay. Money's not a factor to God. He is money, because he's the word. Come buy of me gold tried in the fire. He's the word. In other words, he's value. Are you hearing me? Let me share this with you. When a heart is not right, there's daily lies being manifested. Are you hearing me? When the heart is not right, you lie to yourself all the time. How many have found themselves in the Word? Lift your hands if you found yourself in the Word. Lift your hands. If you found yourself in the Word, lift your hands. Now, don't let that lie in your heart tell you. Don't lift your hand up. Don't lift your hand. You've just shut off. Just shed off the hindrance that was in your heart. See, a lie coupled with embarrassment will say, don't do it. Don't lift your hand up. Keep your hand down. But when you're real about you and you want to be saved, sanctified, and in the pleasure of the Father, here I am, Lord. When you need Jesus, you gotta go to him for a specific reason. See, he's spirit. He's spirit. So your heart is connected to spirit. And so if your spirit is not washed, your life is not washed. Because your life will be contaminated with different type of emotions. Different circumstances will cause you to respond and react physically. And you'll never gain the life that you're supposed to in Christ Jesus. But from out of the heart, from out of your heart, if you're sincere, then when you talk to the Lord, hallelujah, thank you, Lord, hallelujah. When you come to him and say, Lord, this is who I am. This is what I've been holding back. I'm not a good this, I'm not a good that, Lord. I just tend to mess up, and I don't want to mess up no more, Lord. Ooh, the care of the Father when he comes into your presence. He just digs inside your heart because you don't mind giving it to him. You will experience what they call a giving up. And when you give up, the burden that was in your heart is gone. You're so light spiritually from out of your heart. And when you become light like that, note that God took your cares and he took what you confessed to him, took it with him and forgave you for it. When you experience that, you'll want to do it again. You'll want to do it again, okay? You took that, Lord. Well, here, take this too, Lord. I don't want to be the type of person to go on ahead and quickly respond to something, Lord, and I find out that I responded to something and it made me look like a liar, Lord. Forgive me for being a liar in my actions. Forgive me for being a liar in my actions. Forgive me for not being truthful within myself, Lord, let alone not being truthful with you, Father. Oh, man, when you say that from out of your heart, Jesus will be right there. He'll be right there. See, because he is love, he knows how to love past infraction. And because we're paganists, we picked up a mind from the world. So now the world doesn't consist of buildings and all of that stuff. The world consists of the mindset that the world responds in. So if the pride of life is there, and the lust of the eye is there, Sometimes what we lust for, if we don't lust for Jesus and lust for natural things, we'll end up finding out that we'll push Jesus aside for the sake of obtaining the natural abundance. That's where the word of God says, what will profit a man to gain the whole world? To gain the whole world. To gain the adorning of the world. To gain the power of the world. And lose his own soul. Then there's a question, he said, what will a man give in exchange for his soul? And the devil came to tempt Jesus and said, you can have all of this good report among this whole world. You can have all this if you just bow down and serve me. Bow down and live by what I make you feel like. Because I know that is to say, in my flesh dwells no good thing. So if I respond based upon how I feel, then I'm not living an accurate life. I'm not living an accurate life. I'm living a teeter-totter life. Sometimes up, sometimes down. Sometimes up, sometimes down. Sometimes up, sometimes down. And we never have consistency in whatever situation goes in our life. Faith keeps you consistent in your ups and downs in life. Faith says the Lord will make a way somehow. But faith can't come if faith can't be established in your heart. Faith can only be established as if the abundance of the heart gets to be outpoured. Now, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. When the word of God comes to you about you and begins to teach you things about you, whether personal or whether you're at home, then let me tell you something. God will take, he'll take a time for you at home to show you how impatient you really are. If you neglect to hear that part about you, then the word has been rejected. Now, that word can't get inside your heart because pride has become the barrier to hinder that seed from flourishing and coming up and bringing patience unto 30, 60, and some 100-fold. I'll be out of your way. But God has mercy. Sometimes the Lord will allow things to happen to you for the sake of building you. Sometimes he'll step back and let the devil beat you upside your noggin for the sake of tempering you. If I put you in fire, will you still come out the same? And if we don't have our heart, if we don't have our heart right with the Father, when the enemy comes to temper, then we'll get discouraged and want to leave the Lord. And we will say dumb things like, I ain't leave God. The commitment that you had before shows that you left him. Because God the Father says, listen, assemble yourself the more in the house of God. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. So something is in the heart that's causing the action of man to digress in the loyalty that was supposed to be demonstrated. I declare unto you, the Father has spoken to us today. From yours truly, even me, the Lord has blessed me. As he blessed you today. See, I'm not proud. Because there's no reason to be. Because I got to be clean like you do too. And I give God the glory for his word today. Because he's elevating us. And when God elevates, blessings overflow. I'm not concerned about how you view me. When I die, you ain't gonna be next to me. I'm gonna be standing all alone before the Father, before Christ. And as he sits at the judgment seat, my record will come in my mind. And if I don't, as a leader, demonstrate. I don't want to just be an illustrator because I know word or whatever the case might be. No, I want to be a demonstrator. Apostle Paul said, I didn't come to you with excellency of speech, declaring unto you man's wisdom, but I came unto you with demonstration of spirit and of power. The word of God is life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. I feel him moving in me right now. The word, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The word, glory be to your wonderful name. The word is life. We've just been given life right now. We've just been given life right now. What an amazing God he really is. That he would even bless us to this capacity of still loving us beyond our fault and seeing our need. That's a mighty God. There ain't nobody like him. There ain't nobody like Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He's so caring for you. So merciful. There's no love like his. No greater love has a man than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends. He said, I lay down of myself. To help you out. He did it so that you can have life. He did it so that you won't have to struggle. That your heart will be pure to serve him in the right manner. Isn't he such an awesome God? He knows how to get into all of our hearts. Hallelujah. It really causes us to think about who we really are. You've learned a lot about you today. You've seen, heard about you today. You've seen you in your actions today. You've heard about how negligent you were today. You've heard about how messed up you really were. But you also heard about how much he cares for you. We heard about how unworthy we are, but yet how worthy we are. If it wasn't so, his long suffering, you wouldn't have experienced it today. Today, you experience the long suffering of the Father. When I acknowledge that what he did today was bless me, and I can't help but to thank him for his goodness. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Bless your wonderful name. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. How many of us heard that we had things stored in our heart? Lift your hands. And the things that you had stored in your heart, you realize is there now. How many realize that the things that you had stored in your heart hindered you this week that just passed? That God has forgiven you for that? How many believe God has forgiven you for that? Thank you, Jesus. want you to go to Isaiah. Thank you, Lord. Glory be to your name. Thank you, Lord. I want you to go to Isaiah. Thank you, Jesus. 54. I want to share this with you while you're going to Isaiah 54. You must go through a spiritual warfare. See, contamination wants to be around. And the only one who contaminates is the enemy. You must go through spiritual warfare. Must go through it. Spiritual warfare is where you have a fight within you. You have a fight within you. In Romans 7, he said, there's a war within my members. There's a war with my mind, and there's a war with my flesh. There's a war with how I want to be, and there's a war with how I feel to be. There's a war within my flesh, warring against the law of my mind. It's warring. What I feel is fighting against where I believe I need to be. It's fighting. I feel it. And trying to bring me down to the law of sin, which is in my members. And when it tries to bring you down to the law of sin, it's trying to keep you, to slow you down in your commitment. It's trying to slow you down in your seeking. It's trying to slow you down in your believing. It's trying to slow you down in your faithfulness. That war within your members trying to hinder you. Apostle Paul picked it up, and he found out that if my service to God is based upon my flesh, then I'm really serving sin. But if my mind stays on the Lord, then my service to God is by my spirit, which is my mind. But if my mind gets to be swayed to believe that what I feel is the truth about me, then my heart is contaminated with deception. So now, there's a war. Because that what I want, I don't do. And that I don't want to do, that do I. So now, I find out, if I do that which I don't want to, hear me, I consent to the word of God, that what I'm doing that I don't really want to do is good, it's okay for me to do it. So now I feel bad. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? The body of this frailty. The body. He said, I thank God that with my mind, I serve God. But with the flesh, if I serve God from out of my spirit and overcome and conquer what I feel, and listen, and allow the Spirit of the Lord to have his way, then I'm serving God in my spirit. But if I serve him on my flesh, then I serve sin. Isaiah 54. Amen. Bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Isaiah 54, verse 17. Choir, I want you to get ready to come up. Isaiah 54, verse 17. Go ahead and read.
No weapon.
No what?
No weapon.
No weapon. No weapon. Go ahead.
That is formed against thee shall prosper.
Are you hearing this? Read that again.
No weapon.
No weapon
formed against thee shall prosper.
No military operation, no spiritual warfare. No spiritual warfare. No enemy. No, nothing that is made to weaken you shall what? Shall prosper. Shall what?
Prosper.
Shall prosper. Anything that comes up against you to try to weaken you or try to get you to believe, oh, still got that in you, that's a weapon. That's a weapon. Any deceptive word against you is a weapon. Any attitude that you feel is a weapon. Any feeling of discouragement is a weapon. Any frustration that want to make you fight, that's a weapon. Any malicious emotion is a weapon. And the Father said, no weapon, nothing formed. Nothing, no weapon. That is what?
That is formed.
That is formed against you.
Shall prosper.
Go ahead.
And every tongue.
And every what?
Tongue.
Tongue now. Tongue, you know, I looked up the word tongue. Tongue don't mean like a tongue per se that a tongue is. Like how you have, you all have. Tongue means anything, it's a babbler. It's a babbler. A tongue is a babbler. One who speaks evil, who has another language than the word of God. Another language than the word of God. We all know that is to say in our flesh dwells no good thing. So why do we allow flesh to stop us? When it ain't real. Tongue means, it means a tongue wedge, a tongue wedge. I want you to hear me. You know, sometimes we don't understand that when we're talebearers, we become tongue wedge. If you hear something, if you overhear something and all that, and you hear something, you go back and you tell brother such such and sister such such and such such, and you go home, you tell your wife, or you tell your husband, or you go ahead and do this, snap, blah, 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 and it ain't got nothing to do with you. You a talebearer. You're a tongue wedger. That's what flesh is interested in talking like that. Flesh is concerned about those things. When it ain't got nothing to do with you. Lord said, I want you to study that word wedge. Wedge means, hear me, wedge means something causing a breach or separation to force one's way into. To force one's way into. To separate or force apart with. Are you hearing this? To force and you separate by being concerned, wanting to know, playing detective. Are you hearing me? There's no weapon formed against you that shall prosper, and any tongue, anything that a spirit tells you to do. Do you understand this? If a spirit tells you you ain't no good, do you know a spirit will also tell you to be a busybody? A spirit will tell you, well, you ain't got that much information. Go find out what's going on with them. Go find out what's going on with them. Go find out what's going on with them. Find out what's going on with them. Find out what's going on with them. And if you a talebearer and it's juicy fruit, my fruit is word. Word is fruit. The fruit of the spirit. The spirit is word. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit. So if it's fruitful, you want to share. And you start contaminating. Because in your heart, you will talebearer. In your heart, you can't hold your leaky vessel. In your heart, you just have to let everybody know what goes on. Hey, you know what I heard? Oh, man, guess what, man? Negative gossip is so good to say when it's in your heart. When you're a talebearer, the more info, the better. But when you're not a talebearer, you're going to say, that ain't my business. When you're not a talebearer, you say, I don't even want to hear it. When you're not a talebearer, you mind your business. But if you're a talebearer, well, what you say? That'd be your business. When you're a talebearer, you want to know everything. And when you find out, let me go talk to the pastor. A lot of folk minding their own business up in here. Let me check you out. Check you out. You overhear bits and pieces and you create your own conversation. No, that's what I heard. That's what they told me. Whenever tail-bearing is in your heart, well, Lord, I wasn't planning on talking about this, but Lord, have your way. Whenever tail-bearing is in your heart, you always revert back to that in private settings. You want to know what I heard? Check this out. Yo. So anyways, are you hearing me? The things that you're supposed to tell your leader, you tell everybody else. Oh, it's pretty quiet up in here, huh? Are you hearing this? Now, I don't understand conversating about overcoming this and overcoming that. But when you're the first one to get the news, instead of stopping it there, everybody else on your way to the pastor got to know about it. This is how contamination starts in the church. This is how it stays in the church. But thank God we ain't got to deal with that, right? Thank God we ain't got to deal with that, right? Amen. Thank God we ain't got to deal with that, right, y'all? But somebody's offended here. Somebody is offended here. Tail-bearing is the key that the devil uses to accuse. He was a tail-bearer in heaven.
happened when he went and divided the angels' tail bearing, telling them, just straight telling the tale. He didn't talk about when he was kicked out and all that, the tail drew a third part. He didn't have a tail with an arrow at the end. No, it was his, when he was speaking, drove them all out. When I first heard that, I thought the devil had a long tail. So, holy smokes, he got a long tail. You throw me out, you, and all that. Come on, let's go. It wasn't like that. The tail was what was spoken. Drew a third part of heaven. This is the reason why your conversations should only be about Jesus. Nothing about nothing in no church, nobody's background, nobody's history, nobody's home, nobody's nothing. And that's how God becomes God in everybody's life. And now you become somebody's God by giving them consolation. Are you hearing me? Ooh, it was pretty quiet when we talk about tail bearing, huh? It was pretty quiet, huh? No weapon formed against you shall prosper, and any tongue that causes separation, any tongue, any spirit that causes you to just, you can't just keep your mouth quiet. You can't even pray for them. You gotta talk about them. Talk about the situation. Say, well, that ain't right. Well, this shouldn't. Oh, man, that shouldn't even be done like that. Oh, man, come on, man. You know, I think I wish you do. You should do what the words say do. Shut up. Because a still tongue carries a wise head. Hear me? Because when you keep your mouth shut, you carry wisdom in your spirit. That ought to be something that you give it to God for. And when you give it to God, you don't remember it later on down. Oh, yeah, I remember that. Are you hearing me? Hear me very closely. Read that again.
No weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper.
Yes.
In every tongue that shall rise against thee.
In what?
In judgment.
In judgment.
Thou shalt condemn.
Thou. Listen to this very carefully. I literally thought, I want you to hear me very closely. I literally thought that the word said that God is going to condemn. You condemn. Read that again.
In every tongue.
Every tongue.
That shall rise against thee.
That shall rise against thee. Any tongue, any evil speaking that shall rise. To rise means, I want you to hear me, to raise and to establish and to perform and to stir up against you. To rise up against thee in what manner?
In judgment.
In verdict. Finding you guilty. You're guilty. No good. In verdict, in a sentence, in order, in a fashion, in discretion. Do you understand this? And discretion means the result of separating. Power, listen, power of free decision or latitude of choice. Power of free decision or latitude of choice. You ain't got to do that no more. I don't want to do it no more. I don't want to do this no more. I don't want to do this. I don't want to do that. I don't want to be here. I don't want to be there. That's what will happen when you listen to the tongue and that evil demonic spirit tells you, you ain't good enough to be here no more. You ain't good enough to be there no more. You'll start giving up different things about you. You'll start giving different things about you. God put you in places and you start giving it up. Your whole complexes and judgments against you. You say, I don't want to do it no more. Judgment. Any any tongue that shall rise, any evil speaking that rises up against you to tell you you ain't good enough, you should just give that up. You a hypocrite. You ain't no good. You've been feeling this way for a long time. You need to just stop that stupid stuff and give up your title. Don't want you, you a straight hypocrite. Look at you. The Bible told you to put it under subjection. The Bible told you to tell that evil spirit to get behind you. The Word of God gave you power. He gave you power. Do what Jesus did. Get behind me, Satan, in the mighty name of Jesus. You got that power to use it. It's like having a gun and you don't even use it in a gunfight. You running with a gun in your hand. Shame on us for knowing what to do and taking the weak way out. Shame on us for allowing our emotion to rule and to dictate us. Shame on us for giving up what God the Father has given you. What if one day I give up? Say, I'm done being a pastor. Forget you, I'm moving to Buffalo. Forget you, I'm moving to Florida. Forget you, I'm moving to Vegas. Can't see that happening, Pastor. I can't either, and I won't. Because that ain't even in my heart to do. I'm in it for the long haul. I'm going to die serving God. I'm going to die serving God. And any tongue that shall rise up against us in judgment, any tongue that rises up against us to say that we're not good enough, any tongue that rises up against us to say we're a hypocrite, any tongue that rises up to say, oh, you all messed up in your mind, and this is that, blah, 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 you should go on ahead. Thou, you shall condemn. That is an order from the Father. You gonna condemn it. The Bible said that Jesus condemned sin in the flesh. In other words, that tongue that rose up against his mind to judge him, to make him believe that he wasn't no good, he condemned. And you've seen the actions in Matthew's. If thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. You know what that feeling was? A feeling of discouragement. You're reading the feeling of discouragement. If you be, Jesus didn't pay no mind. He said, listen, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of, you see how he depended on the word of God, but by every word that proceeded, not by bread alone, but by every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God, not out of the mouth of your feeling. Listen to what happens now. Read that again now.
And every tongue that shall rise against thee in judgment.
In what?
In judgment.
I still can't believe that.
Thou shalt condemn.
The power of free decision or latitudes of choices. You know, you don't have to do that no more. You know, the verdict is that you feel like a hypocrite. So, you know, you're really a hypocrite right now. What you feel, you believe it. And because you feel what you believe, it's real to you. You ought to be blessing the Lord for hearing the truth about how you used to be instead of staying quiet. Because if that's still in you, then you're offended at the truth. And offense comes when the word exposes you and you don't want to hear it. So you don't say amen to the truth. You sit here quiet. If it ain't you, you ought to be happy. Thank you, Jesus. Glory be to God. If it is you, you're going to stay shut. Because you're like, huh? Talk about me again? Yes, Jesus talks about you again. If he don't talk about you, you'll never get saved. If he don't talk about you, you won't know what to go ahead and change. I'll be out of your way. I'll be out of your way. I'll be out of your way. But when you go on ahead and you do things on the opposite end, thou shalt condemn. The scripture says, thou shalt condemn. You shall condemn. You shall declare it to be wrong against you. You shall declare, you violating me, man. Get behind me in Jesus' name. You shall declare that it needs to take up a back seat. Listen, why? Read now, why?
This is the heritage.
This is the possession. This is your portion. This is your estate of
the servants of the Lord.
Of the servants of the Lord. And
their righteousness.
And the righteousness that you, the faith that you're holding on to, the faith that you're holding on to is
of me.
Is of the Lord.
Saith the Lord.
Saith the Lord. Philippians chapter 3. I'll be out of your way. I'll be out of your way. When the word comes to you and you've been delivered, you ought to rejoice. But if the word comes to you and you sit here trying to think, is it me or is it me? Is it me or is it me? Is it me? You're not making place to receive the word. You're making place for a deity to condemn you with that word. You've just been delivered from all that was in your heart. And you're going to stay quiet over the word of God telling you more about things? First Peter, First Peter chapter 4. Stay in Philippians, but give me First Peter chapter 4. I just need one verse. Glory be to God. Philippians chapter 4, verse 12. Listen now. Excuse me, 1 Peter. Holy smokes. Bear with me, y'all. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Go ahead.
Beloved, think it not strange.
Don't think that this isn't supposed to happen to you. When you think it's strange, you start to complain about it. When you think it's strange, you start saying this ain't fair. When you think it's strange, you really believe that this is out of your league. This is just crazy that this happened to me. When you think it's strange, you get offended. When they think it's strange, you get mad. When you think it's strange, oh, you get deeply upset. Oh, when you think it's strange, you want to leave the church. When you think it's strange, you need a break. Think it not strange, what?
Concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you.
Which is to what?
Try you.
It's to try you. What was it there to do? to try you. It's there to show you. It's there to expose you. It's there to show you exactly what's in your heart. We don't want to know what's in our heart. If you want to be saved, you want to know what's in your heart. Tell the Lord, show me me, Lord. Get ready after service. We ain't got no business holding each other down. Help those. Ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. You gotta help those. Look for them. Call them. Find out what's up with them. Listen to what he says now. Thinking not strange what?
Concerning the fiery trial.
Yes.
Which is to try you.
Yes.
As though some strange thing happened unto you.
You know that word think means think it not. Think it not means don't entertain it. Don't entertain. When you entertain something, you allow yourself to continually think on it. When you're entertaining something, you understand me? It's a lot. When somebody's entertaining you, they're doing stuff in front of your face to keep you alert. Do you understand? When a thought, an evil thought is in your mind against you, and you allow that to go on ahead and wallow in your mind, you're allowing entertainment in your spirit to happen. And when you allow entertainment in your spirit to happen, listen, you are allowing those fiery trials. Those fiery trials is the calamity as a test. Now, the calamity is the misfortune which brings great distress upon individuals. To bring great distress upon individuals is cause you to be burdened about what you're going through. Burdened. Weighted down. Held down. I just can't seem to. That's burden. Don't. When you entertain those emotions, those feelings, it'll bring you down. Amen. Thinking that strange concerning what?
The fiery trial, which is to try you.
As
though some strange thing happened unto you.
In other words, you're blown away. I can't believe it. Go to Philippians chapter 3. Hurry up. I want to have choir. I want you to get ready. But we're going to bless the Lord before we leave. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Philippians chapter 3. Amen. Glory be to God. Philippians chapter 3. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Go ahead and read 20 and 21. Listen now. I want you to hear this now.
For our conversation is in heaven.
Now, hear this now. Our conversation is in where?
Heaven.
It's where?
In heaven.
It's in heaven. So if we're conversating about things of God, we won't get caught up in tailbearing. If we're conversating about the goodness of the Lord, nobody's business will be in our mouth. If we're conversating about how great God is, then we won't err in our conversation. But if we conversate about everything else but Jesus, then you're a tailbearer. Are you understanding me? Now, tailbearing is not you talking about sports or you talking about wood or building a house and all of that. That's not tailbearing. Tailbearing is when you take somebody's negative situation and you keep it in your mouth to go on ahead and give your opinion about this, that, and the third. That's tailbearing. Are you hearing me? Tailbearing is when you cannot seem to shake everybody's business from out your mouth. Holy smokes. You must want to hang out with a tailbearer, you'll be a tailbearer yourself. So you must want to hang out with liars, you'll find yourself lying here and there. absolute truth. This is what he says now. Philippians chapter 3, verse 20 and 21. Go ahead and read.
For our conversation
for
is
our
in heaven.
For our conversation now is what?
In heaven.
From?
From whence also we look for the Savior.
We look for who?
The Savior.
The Savior, who?
The Lord Jesus Christ.
Now, if we do anything different, then we're of ourselves and not of the Lord. Listen to what he says now. Why? Why should we keep our conversations about the Lord? Because
who shall change?
He's going to change
our
what?
Vile body.
This body right here that you have right now, I don't care how good, how much cologne, how much perfume, how much you brush your teeth, floss, and all that, that's a vile body you got. That's a body that's got contamination in it. He going to change that body. He going to change your mind first in this body. And when he changes your mind in this body, this body will have a different lifestyle. He'll change your vile bodies. Go ahead.
That it may be fashioned.
That it may be fashioned now.
Like unto his glorious body.
Like unto his glorious body. How? How?
According to the working.
I want you to see this now. Just like the what?
Just like his glorious body, according to the working whereby he
is
able
to
even to subdue all things unto himself.
Now, if we live unto the Lord and his word is in us, the vile body that we have, which releases attitude and emotion, because Jesus came and subdued sin in the flesh, will have the exact same ability to do the same, causing us to be transformed from how we used to think and be and live to his word. And our conversations is in heaven. For once we look unto the word of God, the Savior, the Lord Jesus. Now listen to what he says now. Listen to what he says. Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. Go to the next book over, chapter 3. Amen. Now if our conversation is in heaven, if our conversation is in heaven, and that's all we do is talk about Jesus, then listen to what he says. Colossians 3, 8 and 10. 8 through 10. Go ahead.
But now ye also put off all these.
This is how you go on ahead and you literally, like how the word of God said in Philippians chapter 3, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself, that will happen within you. That will happen within you. When your conversation is of heaven, the working that is in you will begin to happen. And this is what will begin to happen. You'll start to subdue what?
Anger. Wrath.
Malice.
Blasphemy. Filthy communications out of your mouth.
Go ahead.
Lie not one to another.
Lie not one to another.
Seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds.
Now, when you put off the old man with his deeds, you'll talk about the deeds of your old man. You don't make place but make your old man make you feel like you've been abandoned and hurt and all of that. Let me tell you something. I was upstairs in my office. This is absolute truth. A feeling touched me. A feeling touched me of being discouraged. I kid you not. This morning, a feeling touched me this morning in my office, of wanting to give up. At my house, a feeling touched me of being discouraged. But I know what it is. I know what it is. So why concern myself whether if it's the truth about me or not?
because I know who I serve. So now there's a war within my members. No, get behind me in Jesus' name. Are you hearing this? You're going to get touched with this. Just like I get touched with it, you too. But you got to learn. You got to know what you're packing on the inside. Listen to what he says now.
And have put on the new man.
You have put on the new man.
Which is renewed.
Which is, now, to be renewed means that your heart has now understanding of why you're going through what you're going through. This is just a test. It's only a test. So if it's only a test, it don't last always. Listen to what he says now. That the what?
That which is on the new man.
You put on the new man. You put on the new heart. Which is
renewed.
Which is renewed in what?
Knowledge.
In knowledge. How?
After the image of him that created him.
Now you understand that you are now a partaker of Christ's suffering. I'm going to give you one more scripture. I'm going to give you one more book. Listen to what he says now. 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. Glory be to God. After this choir, I want you to come up. 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 1. All right? Praise the Lord. Two to four. I want you to see this now.
Grace and peace be multiplied unto you.
Now, grace and peace can only be multiplied unto you when you hold your conversations in heaven. Grace and peace will not be multiplied unto you if you talk about anything else on the negative sense. God didn't say that you're not supposed to talk about your daily situations that you got to handle. He's not saying that. He's just saying keep gossip from out of your mouth. Stop. Don't put anybody's business in your mouth. Pray for them. Don't talk negative about them and talk about how you should, how they should. Shut your mouth. Keep your conversations in the Lord. And do right. And when you do that, grace and what?
Peace.
Peace will be what?
Be multiplied unto you.
Go ahead.
Through the knowledge of God.
Through the understanding of what you're going through. Go ahead.
And of Jesus our Lord.
And of Jesus our Lord. So in other words, you have the understanding that what you're going through must happen, but you gotta endure such contradiction. Contradiction is when your faith meets against your feeling. Because what you feel and what you believe is two different worlds. Listen to what he says now. Go ahead and read.
According
to
his divine power,
according to his divine ability,
hath given unto us.
He has given unto us, not we ourselves. He has given unto us
all things
that
pertain unto life,
that pertain unto a new lifestyle. That means that we're not short in nothing. It means that we are not short in anything. We got all the peace, all the joy that we can have, plus some. But if your conversations ain't kept in heaven, then grace and peace ain't going to be multiplied unto you. And you won't have the knowledge of the truth. And then when you have the knowledge of the truth, you'll understand that his divine power has given us all things that
pertain unto life
and
godliness.
Through what?
Through the knowledge of him.
Through the understanding of his word that
hath called us
to what?
To glory and virtue.
To glory and excellence. Go ahead and read.
Whereby
uh-huh.
are given unto us exceeding great and precious
I'll help you.
Promises.
Go ahead, brother.
That by these ye might be partakers.
That by these promises you might be a what?
Be partaker.
A partaker of what?
The divine nature.
His divine nature.
How? Having escaped.
Having escaped. Where? In your mind.
The corruption.
The corruption.
That is in the world.
That is in the world. Now, we know that is in the world is the pride of life, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eye. That's the world. So now everybody's got world in them. It's what you do, whether you allow the world to entertain your conscience and your spirit or not. If Jesus' flesh was so holy, he would not be so concerned about pinning it to the cross. If the body of Jesus was so holy, he wouldn't be eager to pin it to the cross. But before he pinned it to the cross, he subdued it by faith. Go ahead and read. We'll be out of here.
Having escaped the corruption.
Having escaped the corruption, which
that,
is what?
That is in the world.
How?
Through lust.
Through lust. Are you seeing this? Through the desires that your flesh wants you to do. You escape that by being obedient from out of your heart. Listen to what he says now. Is that to verse 4? Close up your Bibles. Sunday school lesson is prayer, a prayer of dedication. Come on up, choir. Come on up, choir. Come on up, choir. Are you here? How many want to bless the Lord here today? How many want to bless the Lord here today? How many want to bless the Lord here today? Clap your hands and give God some praise. Clap your hands. Come on, give Him some praise. Give Him some praise. Clap your hands and give Him some praise.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Salvation.
to me one more time. Hallelujah.
Clap your hands and give God some praise. Hallelujah. He is. Oh, yes. All praises. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Glory be to God. Oh, yes. He is. Give him glory, give him glory. Hallelujah. God is good. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
How many got a praise in the spirit right now? Clap your hands and give God some praise. Hallelujah.
The Lord is marvelous, huh? He's marvelous, huh? Let me hear the soprano say, He is so marvelous. He is, praise the Lord. He is so marvelous. He is so marvelous. He is so marvelous. He is so marvelous.
I only hear the kids.
He is so marvelous. He is so marvelous, he is so marvelous, he is. He is so marvelous, he is so marvelous, he is.
This is like trying to start a dead car.
He is so marvelous, he is so marvelous.
Altos. Marvelous, 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 he is. Praise the Lord. Into the hands of our announcer, please.